Welcome to the Transform My Dance Studio podcast. Over the coming weeks, as your dance studio starts to navigate the changes impacting our industry, we are delighted to be giving you exclusive access to some of our best mindset and change management sessions in the Dance Studio Owners Association. We hope you find this mindset episode valuable. And for more support and resources specifically for dance studio owners, please make sure to join our free Facebook group, the Dance Studio Owners Hub.
Da, da, da. Jackie, how to present summer schedule when we aren't really sure when this season will end. Recital scheduled for the end of May. Okay, end of May. And summer session usually starts around mid-July. Yeah, fantastic. So I would, if I was you, and what I've suggested to our members is that, you know, if your summer is running July, August, I would keep talking about summer as your summer schedule is happening, because we don't know any different at the moment, right? We haven't been told any different. We have a feeling that it might not be the same, but we don't really know. What you want to make sure though is your summer schedule, there is an online version of it and an in-person version of your summer schedule. So think about the summer schedule that you put in place, hopefully in January when you released your summer programming. What you want to do is see how that would work virtually. And so when you're promoting it or re-promoting it, you say, hey guys, this is our summer schedule. Great news. If we can't get back into the studio, we're going to be running our summer programming virtually. We've been working really hard with our team to get to be able to make this happen and get a great program in place and make sure it's as interactive and as engaging as it possibly can be. And we're really excited for it. And then you might throw in like some different parties or different themed days, or, you know, they can wear like crazy hair, you know, hair to one of the camp. Like, you, again, you've just got to think about the engagement piece, because we have such short attention spans and you don't have the luxury of having them in the same space together. And so it's your job. You guys are super creative. A lot of you always say to me, Clint, I just wish I could be more creative. I'm just stuck in the day-to-day of my business. That's obviously what we help with. But here is your opportunity to be really, really creative and get your team involved. Guys, you've got teachers that are probably really feeling it at the moment if their hours have been being decreased. Or I know a lot of, depending on your area, but I know we've heard a lot of dance teachers who were also working at a restaurant and maybe they were Uber driving as well or something. Like those, a lot of those jobs have gone now. And so you're probably a lifeline for a lot of your dance teachers. And so get them involved in these ideas as well, because they've got a lot of great ideas. So yeah, Jackie, that's how I would do it. I would present the schedule at normal, but just know that you've got an awesome, exciting online version of summer. And if that's the way that you've got to go, you'll do a big announcement around it, like do a big like Facebook Live, you know, online virtual summer camp, bonanza extraordinaire announcement, like do something big and fun to like get people involved in it. Right. Yeah. This is the fun stuff. What time? Oh, cool. We're doing fine on time. I just want to make sure I get through of everything. Yeah. So Michelle is saying themes. Each week we have a new theme. This also helps teach you with creativity. Yeah. I love that. Emma. Hey, Emma. My venue just announced closure through October 1st. Yeah. So that's late. We're going to see this happening with some venues. And so October 1st, you can still run some type of performance in November and December. Yes, it throws out your year. Yes, it's annoying, but hey, let's still run a show. You know, guys, even if like everyone, you know, goes, like I said, half of the costume fits them, they put the bottoms on, they wear it, you know, they put half of the tutu on and then the top half is a t-shirt, right? We're not going to care, because people will just be so, they'll be so excited to just have an in-person experience. Right. And whether that is in a theater, whether that is out in a park, maybe that's in an amphitheater outside, whether it's online, like however we figure this out, there will be some kind of recital experience. We're just going to get really creative around what that looks like. Maybe our recital turns into a winter show. You know, maybe our recital turns into 20 mini shows over 20 weekends. Right? Who, like, that's the thing. We just got to think outside of the box. and we do not have any insight yet. I mean, Emma's Theatre has said the 1st of October, but we don't know, like, maybe there's another theatre in the area, or there's a different type of space, or there's a high school, or there's a basketball court. I mean, you know, we need to get creative during this time. But as I said, we can't start thinking. We have to think to the future, but we can't really make decisions on things that are more than like 2 weeks out at the moment. I feel like this month in the US anyway is going to be a month for us to get a little more clarity. You know, I think over the next week or so, we're meant to kind of see the cases skyrocket, and their hope is that we will then slowly see them, slowly seeing them come down. We don't know. And then we don't know what impact that's going to have around like businesses opening. But what I will tell you is that this online model that you're currently running will stay. It's not going away. Don't think that your doors will open in July and then there's no more online. There will definitely 100% be dance studios running a hybrid model of their dance studio, whereas there is some kind of online component to the in-person component. Can we or should we start summer camp workshops marketing? Yeah, okay. So you definitely can start that. Depending on when you start them, I've told our members that probably like the 1st of May is going to be a good time to look at summer if you're starting your programming in July or August. You could even push it back a little bit more and do like a 7 to 14 day, I call it like a PAL promotion. It's like a marketing promotion you run just for a very, very short amount of time that has scarcity and incentive. So you essentially, hopefully, sell out is the idea, but you sell a whole bunch of tickets in a very short amount of time to your summer programming. So you would build anticipation for it for about a week, and then you would sell it for 7 to 14 days. And this is why people generally don't do well with summer camps, because you guys try and sell it for 3 months and that doesn't work. We want short bursts. I know some of our IC members did like early bird summer camp in January for a week. And so they do a power promotion. They promote it big for a week and then they don't talk about it again for another like month or two. Then they do like the next round, which has a higher price. The bonuses have gone away. And so you just like want to think about your marketing promotion around that. But Kay, you could start now, but I would strongly suggest that you do like a smaller window so that everything happens. If you guys have seen me talk about selling limited edition merchandise, if you've done Studio Success Formula, it's the same principle. Right, it's the same principle of that promotion of selling limited edition merchandise that you can apply to this. Raza from Argentina, hello, thanks for joining us. I've been working online. Hi, I'm going to read your question. I've been working for a couple of years online. I created an online school of belly dance. I would like to know how to improve my online studio now that everyone is doing online classes free. I know if I offer a good service, reasonable prices, but now I'm a bit worried because everyone discovered this online system. Yeah, so essentially what I've already mentioned, I'm hoping is going to help you around the connection piece. So that's the most important piece, is connection. Hillary from Inner Circle, one of our coaches, she talks about content, connection, and community. I think that's right. Hillary, correct me in the chat if I'm wrong. But I'm thinking I've already answered that question. And I may have already answered your questions as I go through this. So I'm just going to read them. Stacey, does anyone have any advice on how to keep our bodies physically hold up to dancing on really less than ideal surfaces? I'm really hurting. Yeah. Ankles, knees, back. Oh yes. I feel you. So I have done, not that I'm teaching dance classes, but I am doing beach body every day. And I feel like I'm a 6-year-old, like my body is so sore at the moment. So I've done, and it depends on how you need to move and turn, but I got a great mat, a big mat, actually. It's like not like a little mat. I got a big kind of exercise mat, and I put a rug under the mat because my knees are ruined from dancing. Like when I had my first dance studio that I had, you're going to hate hearing this, so block your ears. but it was in like a community hall and the flooring was tiles. I mean, how horrendous is that? And so I'm sure we've all had less than desirable floors that we've had to dance on. So definitely look at that. I would be taking extra collagen if you guys are into taking, you know, like super greens and stuff. I take collagen every day and my knees have been incredible since I started taking it last year. Like everything was hurting. I, you know, had injuries from dance. And since I've taken collagen, it's really helped my joints. So I'm definitely not as sore as I used to be. But Stacey, good question probably for the group, to put in the group. Nadine, one of our Inner Circle members, we had a squad yesterday, now second-guessing my decisions. I did a survey with my customers and decided to drop down from 106 classes to 37 classes, but also gave a very large discount. Thought we would only be in this situation for a month and needed to be able to sleep and live with myself. Now going into May, I'm wondering if I tell my customers that I need to slightly increase the fees because we are not able to cover my expenses. I'm torn. However, because enrollment has been great, we actually have had many new students register, and I know they're registering because of the price. I know proper practice is not to change your mind, but curious in your thoughts. Yeah, Nadine, this is a great question. So a couple of thoughts on this. You could potentially, so if we look at, and I know the model that you're running. So if we look at like a membership model where people are kind of paying like a monthly fee, you can definitely go down the volume game. So you've said that you've already had new people interested. Work out how many new students would you need to bring into this model to make it feasible for you not to have to increase your prices, right? So that's one thing that you can do. You're kind of banking that you will be able to bring those new students in. But I know you. I think you could definitely be able to do that, is to bring new students in. The other thing is, depending on how you use the messaging when you told them about, you know, when you told them about the discount, you could definitely re-message and let them know that you, you know, gave them a great deal, you know, a great pricing for May, for April. But, you know, to ensure that the studio stays around and you have a physical studio to come back to, this is going to be the regular pricing that we're going to carry forward over the next amount of months until we're back into our studio. I'll unmute you, Nadine, so you can chat.
Okay.
Hi, friend. Any
thoughts? I'm on speakers today because I'm homeschooling too. Yeah. So my problem is too, is that we just got kind of word too that on social media, now I'm like really worried because now one of my like big competitor schools just announced that they're offering classes for $20 a month. And if you register in four, they're going to give you an additional $5 off. And I'm like, that's crazy.
Here's the thing though, Nadine, and this is what I keep, you know, and I've mentioned this in a couple of our office hours. The people that are doing, that have these crazy pricing structures, they have not factored in that they will need to be able to charge this amount for like the next 4, 5, 6 months. And their business, they haven't mapped out the scenarios. They haven't done their numbers. And so they're essentially shooting themselves in the foot, right? And so I know it's so hard for us to see, like, you know, people in our area that are doing like free classes for a month or pay what you want or, you know, these types of things. That they can work, but most of the time they don't because they haven't been thought out, right? Yeah. And so no one, but you have to be, I want you to be confident because I know that you guys provide an incredible service. You have incredible training and teaching. You're an incredible leader. Like that is why people are coming. They're not going to switch just because it's cheaper. That's why the building the community piece and the engagement piece is so, so important.
Yeah.
People by people, you know, no one's you.
Right. Yeah. So we've been spending a lot of time on that. And I feel like our numbers are doing pretty good right now. Like we're getting, I just was like, you know, even if I charged $10 more or something going to make, or do I just like leave it, ride it out? We're doing fine. We'll get through.
Yeah.
And just really work on community and loyalty and
Yeah.
You know, we're going above and beyond for our customers is kind of what I've been really like focusing on.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Totally. And I mean, here's the thing though, like that's the new normal. Like anyone who's not going above and beyond at the moment, like won't survive this. Mm. You know, like the over delivery has just become the new normal at the moment. And that's what everyone is doing to ensure they're delivering value, you know, constant value to their dance families. Work out the numbers. If you can, here's how I would run my scenarios. I would work out your current pricing model for May. Are you running a different summer program or are you going to run the same thing through?
Well, I'm in debates. We have like 5 camps that we were supposed to run and one is like quite an intensive. I got to figure out how we could do that online or we would just go into this or we just keep this model, right? So
yeah, so I think
that if kids are still in their situation, I think that they might be, you know, okay with keep on going with regular classes. What else do they have to do, right?
Exactly. So exactly. I'm suggesting to you that you keep this monthly schedule running until you go back into the physical studio. Let's say it's September. I would keep running this model and then you can introduce different fun things, right? Like just during it. And then your goal is just to keep putting more students into the model, right? Into the virtual studio. If you can work it out. So let's work out your scenario. So you should map out same amount of students, May, June, July, August. What does that look like financially? I would do a 10% decrease, May, June, July, August. I'd also work on a 20% decrease.
Okay.
And then I would, you know, you can run a 10% increase as well, or a 20% increase. Like you can run those like 6 different scenarios, but you really want to run the scenarios which are the losing people scenarios. Just right. To see how that would affect you. Then look at those numbers. And then you can go, okay, you know what? We're going to be okay. We can stick with this or no, we're going to need to raise the price by $10. And we can then have a conversation inside the IC about how you value stack it. So what value, if you're charging an extra $10, you've given them a month of this price, it's going to be hard to say, by the way, it's an extra $10 a month and I'm not doing anything else. Although I'm already killing myself and over delivering. You know, I'm not giving you anything else. And so we would just have to work out if you do need to increase it, let's think about some incentives or some like value bundles we could put together.
Okay. Perfect. Thank
yeah.
you so much.
Yeah, cool. We can keep chatting. Monsoon Dance Company. Okay, I'm confused about all the different online offerings out there and what my dance studio should offer. I'm debating between continue to offer semester style classes. We usually offer 8-week to 12-week sessions, but I'm unsure if parents or adults want to commit to longer term classes. Open up all classes and pay as you go, donate. No, don't do donate. I feel this will confuse my regular paying customers or C, offer a mix of the above. Yeah, so I'm hoping Monsoon, the question that Nat asked me around the different models might have helped. So you're running 8 and 12 week courses now. Like, is that your normal model?
Yeah, my normal model is, thanks, Clint. I'm Karishma, by the way. My normal model is like, you know, going by the school year. So we have a fall semester and then we have this recital season from Jan through May, which is a little bit longer. And so now summer's coming up. So my classes end on May 10th. The session ends on May 10th. So I don't want to just be one of those rushing and offering a model out there. I really want to think through
what do you generally do in summer?
In the summer, usually I offer just a regular, we offer our regular classes. And then we started summer camps last year for the first time, just for 2 or 3 weeks for 1 month. So we're new. So this is my third year.
Okay. And so I would probably, I mean, there's a couple of ways you could go. One of the ways is that you just kind of keep running the current schedule that you're running now. And you just keep running it through, like all the way through. you could do a condensed version of that schedule. I wouldn't, we have people doing like 4 and 6 week courses at the moment, like online courses. And
that's where I was leading. I was wondering, should I reduce it to 4 or 6 week sessions where,
it's going okay. But you know, I think consumers, you know, consumers are used to monthly subscriptions where they can cancel at any time. And so you may want to go like do a monthly subscription for, you know, the rest of May, June, July, and August and just create your own schedule. And then you just replicate it. You know, the problem people have with summer is they complicate it, right? So they have like this camp and that camp and a half day this and a full week this. And so it like becomes so complicated. What I'm loving about the situation we're in is this gives us the opportunity to like streamline our offering. And so you may want to look at just like a monthly, you know, a monthly fee that they pay and they get access to the different type of content. Mm-hmm. But only, you know, only you can kind of answer, you know, I don't know the ins and outs of your business and we don't have time to like jump into it. So, but that's
for a reduced pricing if we do like per class or keep the price.
I would keep the price.
Okay.
Yeah. I would, unless you're doing like, it's like, I know one of our members who does like, pole dancing and aerial work. And they're now doing floor like core work and they charge a premium for their pole and aerial silk classes. Like, they've got a different pricing model for their floor work because it's a different experience, right? We had one member that was doing an after-school program where they pick them up and give them a snack and stuff. Obviously, that after-school program has shifted, right? So that warrants a different price structure. But if you're teaching a five-year-old preschool ballet class, you know, and you're teaching it in the studio and now you're teaching it at home, like it's a virtual studio, I mean, I'd be keeping the price the same. So you just got to look at the experience.
Okay. Thank you.
Awesome. You're welcome. Nice to talk to you. We'll come down to Mirage, I think. My landlord said that the rent has to be paid and wanted me to do a promise to pay in September. He's not doing a discount. He also said that I can get a loan from them interest-free and incorporate it into my payment when this is over. That's nice. He also said that the commercial mortgages are not giving them a break, so he cannot give me a break. He'll not kick me out, but I will have to owe the money without any discount. I'm concerned that since the kids are going to school online and not attending as parents are getting frustrated. When all this is over, the parents will have to pay for their kids to be tutored to catch up. Will we be in business if the kids have to get tutored so that they can maintain the same grade level? Look, I don't think you're going to have any issues there. You know, I can't, just from what I've seen and from some of my friends that work in government education, I highly doubt that they're going to, like, that people are going to get tutors and they're going to have to make all of this up. If it's long, like, if people are off for the rest of the year, there's no way they're going to do that. They'll come up with some kind of abbreviated plan to help, but, like, that wouldn't be my concern. I wouldn't be concerned that I'm, like, not going to, like, parents are not going to have money because they're paying tutors. I wouldn't be focused on that. And I think what your landlord does, I mean, it sounds like a very understanding landlord who wants to work with you to give you the best option. And so I would definitely be working with them on, you know, helping you out. And yes, you're not going to, you probably won't get free rent. Like someone's going to have to pay, you're going to have to pay your rent at some time. And so if they're back ending it to the back of your lease, I mean, that, you know, that buys you some more time. What are some ideas for ways of adding extra value to their online tuition fees to allow us to limit discounting and adding value? I love the idea of offering last year's recital videos for free. Any other ideas? Yeah, this was like nearly an hour ago. So, hopefully I've answered some of your questions. Parties, give them activity packs like coloring packs, give them Spotify playlists. that they can listen to, you know, additional pre-recorded, like pre-recorded content that you can share, like Zoom sessions where they can just like chat and chew, like have dinner or have lunch together as like a group, do things for, you know, the parents, bring, you know, partner with your local businesses, get like the local doctor on to talk about like protecting yourself, like run a webinar on that, bring the local yoga teacher on to run like a morning yoga kid-free lesson with your parents. I mean, you know, there's a bunch of stuff. Okay. Oh, good. Michelle, should we create a new name and logo for our online studios? Yeah, so some people have like called their studio like Online Academy or, you know, Susie's Dance Online. And so don't have like Susie's Dance and then, you know, open Stephanie's Dance Online, right? So make sure that there is like, there's unity to your brand, because this will most likely probably become another part of your business that you will end up offering in the long run. Okay, Naomi, Clint, thanks for everything. You are welcome. We are following everything you said. You're my favorite person in your live stream a few weeks ago, and it's working. Yes, I hope you're not surprised about that. We're a 160 student studio and we've only lost about 5 kids. Good, but have 8 new registrations this week because we're online. Amazing. What I'm wondering is summer programs. We can't do full day camps like we used to. Love ideas of how summer programs work. Okay, again, this was like from an hour ago. So I feel like I have answered that question, but if you have a follow-up, let me know. Parents are taking in so much information online and constant emails from their schools. How do we communicate without getting annoying? I want to make sure my messages... Okay, great. So you need to be concise in your communication and you need to be as entertaining as possible, right? So there's this edutainment, which is like educating and entertaining people. This is what allows you to stand out and not be annoying, right? So think about how can you engage your parents? I've seen a lot of people like doing dances on like TikToks with their kids and like announcing stuff. And like you gotta get fun and you've got to get people paying attention. I've seen people who like take a photo of themselves and they'll write like, read your email. And it's like the studio owner like holding a piece of paper, right? Like super basic, but people are going to read that. So think about how can you get in front of people that is different in you? You can send them Facebook voice messages, depending on how many kind of students you have. You can do Facebook Live. So I talked on my Facebook Live a couple of weeks ago that like once a day you should be jumping into Facebook and doing a Facebook Live and like telling, oh, your teacher's getting in there saying, hey guys, it's Tuesday. Happy Tuesday. We've got an incredible lineup for our online academy today. Let me walk you through the schedule. We've got clogging with Clint. We've got this with that. We've got ready, set, dance. Like whatever we've got going on, like what programs you have on, share this, right? Share it with your customers and get them engaged. Because if you're just sending emails, like boring emails, like the newsletter from like 1985 with the silhouette dancer and it looks horrendous, like no one cares. No one is going to pay any attention to that. Right? Think of new ways you can get in front of people. You running an online dance studio, you have to be a master of marketing. There has never been a more important time in your life as a CEO of your studio. Like, do you need to be a marketer? Because everything that you're doing needs to be marketed to your customers. And when I say marketing, I'm not talking about like being pushy and salesy. You just have to keep consistently telling them, you know, what you're doing, how you're adding value, and not by saying, hey guys, I'm adding heaps of value to you because we're doing a princess tea party. You're saying to them, hey guys, I'm super excited. In 2 days, we're going to release the wait list for our princess tea party. If you want to come join the wait list, we only have 20 places available. It's going to be free, you know, whatever, right? But you've got to keep building anticipation, build anticipation. And then, you know, deliver on building the anticipation, make the announcement, deliver the value, rinse and repeat. talking about, if you want to see a really good campaign around anticipation and making an announcement, I'm going to be sending you an email on Thursday about something we are doing next week, and I'm making a very exciting announcement next Tuesday. So have I piqued your interest? I have a massive announcement that I am making next Tuesday. We actually have never done this before, so it is pretty big. And so you'll see us build anticipation. I'm going to be emailing you all on Thursday saying you are not going to believe what we are doing next Tuesday. And then you guys would probably want to join me on a Facebook Live next Tuesday at 11 a.m. Eastern so I can share with you what that is, right? But you've got to continuously build anticipation and market the amazing value that you are delivering, right? Marketing just amplifies. It either amplifies you so people see that what you're doing is horrendous and no one should be a part of it, which is none of you, or it amplifies the amazingness, the incredible value that you are doing, right? Like that is the key. That is the key. And the further this goes out, I think there is a good chance that I may not be able to have recital this season. I've talked about that. Mariana, what's going on? Talking about teachers, what should I do about teachers that decide to start teaching on their own through Zoom? Well, how do I want to say this in a nice way? No. And so what you want to make sure, and it's a bit late for agreements, but I'm hoping you all have agreements with your teachers that stop them, or they have to ask you. It depends on what, I can't talk about law because it depends what state you're in, because in some states you can't do this. But you can ask, if you can't stop them because of the law where you are, there are clauses you can have that seek permission. Right. So they have to seek permission from you before they do X, Y, Z. The issue we're in is that none of you probably put like, you can't run online dance classes like in your agreements. And so we're in a little bit of gray. We're in a little bit of gray. And so what you want to do is work with your teacher so that if they want to teach online, if they want to teach classes, like, get there, if they want to teach like new classes that you don't generally do, like bring them under your umbrella, you know, bring them under your umbrella and say, hey, you know, I love what you're doing. You're a part of our dance family. You're one of our dance faculty. I'd love you to teach these classes for us. Like, you know, we have supported you for the last 10 years. And so let's keep this relationship going. Most of the time, people are not doing this out of, they're not being malice about it, right? They're just clueless around how this is affecting your business. They're thinking, and especially if they're doing like free classes and you're like, oh my goodness, why are you doing free classes? Like where people are paying to do your classes at our dance studio. They don't get it. And so you just need to have the very frank, honest conversation with them around what they're, because they're probably like, I love to dance. I'm really bored at home. I'm going crazy in quarantine. I'm going to run free dance classes, right? They might be doing that. And so have the conversation with them around that. And if they want to run a free dance class, run it through your Instagram account, run it through your Facebook Live, right? Then they can go to town, but not too many free things. Please remember that. We are running 53 classes a week using Zoom and pre-recorded videos. All the Zoom classes are recorded and sent immediately. That's not a question. Tabitha, should we offer a 25% reduced fees for online live classes? I'm in Western Australia. Tabitha, I feel like I've answered this. Run through your financial. If you've shifted the offering completely, you will have to do something. If the offer has stayed the same, you want to try and charge the same amount and value stack it. If you're doing a condensed schedule or it's not the same, you may want to offer a discount. If you are offering a discount, make sure that your business can sustain it though. You have to be able to sustain the discount for multiple months. What about performance group classes? What is everyone doing? I've got a bunch of ideas on that, but post that question in the group, because we can have a conversation around that in the group, and you'll get a whole bunch of different answers from people who are doing it. That's a comment. Okay. We have all of our 900 students on year-round membership. Fantastic. We have preschoolers that take fine arts combo classes from 3 hours for 3 hours in a row, should we offer a shorter class at a cheaper rate? Yeah, you totally could do that. Because it's hard to have like little kids for 3 hours at home, because like that's not really a break for the parent, because the parent's like, no, don't eat your foot. No, don't do that. You know, they're like continuously like engaged. And so do a shorter version of it. Or you might want to do like 2 90-minute sessions that you might want to run like back to back. And they can choose if they want to come to one of those or both. So that means you're not going to be losing too much income. We charge by the school term in Australia. We've just finished term one. As we don't know how long this is going to last, would you suggest changing to charging monthly? I'm thinking, although we want people to commit, the fact is they might not have the money and this could stop them overcoming. Yeah. So I would stick with your term. I wouldn't change, because that's like how you guys roll. So I wouldn't change the term piece. I would maybe look at, if you're getting upfront payment for the term, you might want to break the payment up into 2 or 3 payments for people that request it. So I would be not giving every, I wouldn't say, hey guys, if you want a payment plan, send me an email. I wouldn't be doing that. But I would be, if people reach out to you and they're like, look, we're going to drop, or, you know, we really can't afford to pay for the term up front. That's when I would be giving them options. Like if someone wants to drop and you're charging for the term. So just for those who are not in Australia or New Zealand, a term is like 8 to 10 weeks. Then there's like 2 weeks of holidays basically. And so, yeah, I would be giving them the option if they kind of come back to you and can't afford it. Is there a software or system that automates the payment to access to the videos or virtual classes? Yeah, so you can use, if you're using Teachable or Thinkific or Kajabi, these are online membership softwares, you can integrate them with something like Stripe or PayPal, really, but I'd be using Stripe. If you're going to set up the software, I'd probably use Stripe. But there's other merchants you can use as well. So that's super easy. Okay. I do not have new students asking to join yet. This is so new for people in our area. However, what is the best way to say you're allowing new people to join? Are you offering one class rates or a weekly trial? So Heather, because you're in the inner circle, I'll send you a video that Cody did around this last week. So he mapped out like your online funnel of how you get new students into a virtual studio. So can you just email us and we'll send you that. And then next week, Tracy has her week-long Facebook training inside of the IC, Heather, and she's going to walk you through how to do the Facebook ads for a virtual studio. So you'll be good to go. Robin, can you keep teaching tumbling classes? I have no idea, Robin. I think it probably depends on what the age group is, and you would probably need people to have like a mat, or, you know, you don't want someone like doing a cartwheel like into a fireplace or something. So I think that might be a little trickier. Again, post that in the group, because I'm not teaching tumbling and I'd prefer you to get advice from someone who is, because I don't think mine's going to be very good. Jennifer, I love your professionalism and generosity, Clint. Thank you. I'm a one-room studio, 22 years in. If I do live stream class, should I have them pay through the platform itself or pay me direct? Yeah, so you can definitely do it through the platform, but check the rates. Some platforms will charge you a percentage on top of the fees that you will, like the fees you'll be charged. I'd probably just go straight through Stripe or straight through your studio software or straight through PayPal. I would, cause that's like just easy. That's just easy. Tappy Toes, love all these names. We've been using Google Hangouts Meet, but we're thinking of changing the Zoom because we couldn't see all of our dancers. Yeah. However, I've just found a grid view that you can use on the computer, but not sure about on the phone. Is it worth switching, or will this just confuse people? We've done Meet for 3 weeks and are now having a week off. I think if you're happy with Meet, I know that they are looking at trying to get, like, I know they are working on the See Everyone function. I don't know how long that is, but I know that it is happening. If it's working and like people feel connected and the feedback is good from your parents, I would just stick with what you have. You know, throwing in another change for them at the moment, and especially like Zoom. I mean, Zoom is great. We obviously use it. I probably wouldn't do that at the moment. Cool. Our classes were mostly 1 hour and now we are teaching about 35 minutes. Should I charge the same tuition? No. So what I said before, if you have altered your service, which includes time, you don't want to charge the same. If you were running a 45 minute preschool ballet class and it's 45 minutes still, I wouldn't change it. You know, if you have gone from an hour class to a 35 minute class, you know, yes, change your tuition and your instructors should be prorated. Born to Perform. Hello. Our scheduled spring break is next week. Should I stick to that schedule or still offer the schedule as added value? Yes. Continuing offering that the schedule is added value, 100%. Make a big deal about it. Run a Facebook Live around it. Guys, big, exciting announcement. Can't wait to tell you. Join me on the Facebook Live. Then on the Facebook Live, say, hey, guys, you know, I know it's been a really tough month. You guys have been incredible supporting us, loving our live classes, X, Y, Z. So what we've decided to do is to celebrate how awesome our family is here at Born to Perform. We're going to be running a week of bonus classes for everyone. No extra to pay. It's just to say thank you in supporting us. You know, it's helping us keep our studio alive. Does that make sense? Awesome. I think it's Brent, maybe. Cool. Thank you. Okay. Our tuition was, is this a question? Yes. I always want to read them, see if there's a question mark at the end now to see if they're questions as I get into our last 3 minutes. Our tuition was paid back in February for the rest of the season. Yes. I have not had any customers ask for tuition back or want to drop. Should I be offering money back or something for the future? No. If you are delivering the same value that you were, no, you don't, and delivering more value, no, you don't need to offer any money back. I know we've had a couple of people in the similar situation. You know, the people are paid up for the season. I know a couple of members who have had a few of their students ask for refunds, and they've been doing credits for like the new season or makeup classes. So I'd be looking at that, but I wouldn't be doing refunds. Oh, cool. Chrissy's saying Google Meet Grid extension, add to Chrome. Yes, it works. Awesome. Thanks, Chrissy, for that tip. Last question. Amy, we are like so on time. Amy, do you think it's fine to teach your online Zoom classes from your living room? I don't feel like my living room looks very nice or professional. Is it necessary to pimp your living room to look more like a dance studio for your online classes? Hey, Amy, you are not alone. The amount of conversations I've had with our inner circle members over the last 2 weeks, people being mortified that like their teachers are like teaching in their bedroom and like their living room's a mess, or like their dad sitting in the big recliner chair like in the back. Kick out your dad. He can go somewhere else for the time being. I know it's not ideal, and I know that there is a lot of ugly. I know that there's a lot of ugliness out there. And so the first thing I would say to you is get over it. And everyone is very forgiving at the moment, right? People are very forgiving at the moment, and you can even make a joke about it. Say, guys, this is an improvement. My 5 family members are not in the shot. You should have seen it before. Right. So you can joke around and play around with it, because at the end of the day, they just want that. They just want that connection. We've had some of our members that have ordered banners from Vistaprint, just like the easy, cheap pull-up banners. And so just so that there's some branding, I know someone ordered like a couple of big step and repeats to like try and like create a backdrop, and have sent them to their teachers. There's a background you can do on Zoom. So Nat has her Zoom background on. So you can do a background on Zoom. It gets a little wonky when you, like, some of you might have noticed when you move around on Zoom, like your arm kind of disappears for a second, and stuff like that can happen as well. So, yeah, Amy, It's Paula saying, yeah, Canva have released their backgrounds for Zoom as well, but it's a little tricky. So I would make the best with, you know, the best with what you've got, because it's really around at the moment. Like, if this is long term, we'd be having another conversation around it. But this is kind of the now, and people are forgiving, and so we just want to focus on the experience, right? Like, that's the core thing, is the experience is what we want to focus on, and that'll get you through. So my friends, thank you so much for joining me today. I probably won't do another one of these, but I wanted to jump on and kind of give everyone, you know, help as much as I could. But I do have something that is going to help you, and it's free. I have something that's going to help you, and it's free, and I am announcing it next Tuesday. So next Tuesday, 11 a.m. Eastern, teaching you about building anticipation. Join me for a Facebook Live in our hub group, and you're going to love it. You are absolutely going to love it. So friends, thanks for joining me. Please look after yourselves. I know that there is so much going on at the moment, so please take time for yourself. Please, even if it's like 5 minutes, you know, please make sure you're showering. That's really important as well. You know, take some time out. And I look forward to seeing you all next week on my Facebook Live, where I have a special announcement, just in case you forgot, 11 a.m. Eastern. And yeah, keep supporting each other in the hub. If you're in the inner circle, I'll see you tomorrow for another office hours. And yeah, look forward to seeing some great success stories that come out of this challenging time. You guys have got everything that you need. We are obviously here to support you as well. So yeah, take care, everyone. And I'll see you really soon. Bye for now.
Thank you for joining us for this special podcast. To access our virtual dance studio training resources and receive continued support in the Dance Studio Owners Association, join our coaches and community at dsoa.com/join or email us at hello@dsoa.com.